This is The Killing Jar by Anne Brandvig and Rick Becker. Chapter 1. Fatigue tugged Theta Kovac toward sleep. Her thoughts, untethered from her body, rushed here, fidgeted there. She twisted onto her side. 5:19 a.m. It flashed red from the clock radio. She flicked on the lamp and watched a funnel-shaped glow rise like steam. After tenting the sheet over her bony knees, she grabbed her book, Passionate Tomorrows. One by one, Kyle unfastened Lucinda's buttons. Faint with desire, she felt a melting deep in her stomach. Oh, damned prissy heroines, always melting deep in their stomachs or burning high on their thighs. Say it, say crotch, say what you mean. Substituting exact anatomical terms, Theta read until Kyle's lust burst forth like a surging tsunami. She slapped the book on her nightstand and clicked off the lamp. This wasn't good sex, just lousy metaphor. Voices bickered outside, and she waited for a defining sound, more talk or a car door slamming. When it didn't come, she stepped to her window, hitched back the curtains, and stared into the space between her hydrangeas. Goosebumps rose and tingled along her arms. Without exception, she slept with the window open. This morning, the marine air flowing into Portland smelled like fresh-cut grass. Theta latched the window and climbed back into bed. Muzzy pre-dawn light cut a V through the curtain. She rolled onto her back and watched headlights swell across the ceiling. A memory raced through her. That car flashing out of the night to run her down. Oh, don't be silly. That was a week ago. Every night since, she'd drifted right off, so why not tonight? Something inside her clicked. Not so brave, are we? An emphatic burr, like an appliance gone crazy, yanked her back from sleep. Theta snatched her kimono from the chair and struggled with an armhole. In the kitchen, her old fridge hummed, then grumbled into silence. She released her breath in a great whoosh. Now she'd sleep. But the trilling continued, and she turned, trying to track the sound. Night still muffled the living room, piling into corners and mixing with shadows. Yes, the noise came from there, but something else was wrong. The picture window, where were the street lights? Behind dotted Swiss curtains, the window looked mottled, as if smeared by mud. She crept closer and ripped the curtains. Splotches on the glass blistered into bees. Hundreds of crawling bees. She wrenched the curtain rod loose, tripping herself in a filmy net. Clumps of bees, frantic to escape, rose and darted back toward the light. Her toe snagged the curtain and she tripped. One fiery stinger, then another, pierced her neck. The bedroom. Her EpiPen was in the bedroom. Theta crouched and waited for the drone to become one sound, like water or wind. She willed herself, move slow, bees sense panic. After untangling her foot, she flung the curtain over the bees. A wing tickled her lip. She almost slapped it away, but couldn't risk another sting. Already her heart hammered, working against her, pumping venom. Step, pause, breathe became a rhythm to calm the bees, to calm herself. She stumbled down the hall, past the bathroom, to her bedroom, slammed the door, and stuffed her kimono into the crack at the bottom. Dizziness came over her in hot, bitter waves. Breathe. Keep breathing. She heaved the top drawer of her dresser open. Her vision whirled with browns and reds as she flung nightgowns and shook out slips, probing corners of the drawer. Her fingers hunted the EpiPen. It was gone. Her scalp tickled. She raked a bee from her hair. It fell next to a pink negligee and crawled in a stunned, drunken circle. She stumbled across the room, taking in air a pinch at a time. Afraid to shut her eyes, she flung herself on the bed. Don't pass out. She struggled for breath, like a swimmer kicking to rise up and break free of water. Two voices collided in her head. The loudest and most distinct commanded, "Fight!" The other voice whispered, "It's been a grand life." She rolled across the bed, knocked the receiver off the phone, and punched 911. The operator's words sounded far away, and in a dreamlike undertow, the voices in her head unraveled. More surprised than afraid, she followed the softer one. A bee settled on her wrist, its thorax pulsing like a tiny heart.
Okay, I'm going to read in a different character's viewpoint. This is Dog Brody, and she suspects that her husband is cheating. She tries to hire our heroine, P.I. Georgia Lamb, but George is focused on finding Theta's killer. Well, Dawn decides she'll take matters into her own hands. Dawn flipped the dish towel over her shoulder and grabbed a whisk broom, dustpan, and hammer. Through the kitchen window, she watched Ted shoveling gunk around his precious roses, mulching or composting or fertilizing, one of those smelly garden chores. Tonight was the night. She slunk out the front door, half an hour before dark, and the street lights had blinked on. Dawn stood at the end of the driveway, peering up and down the street. The coast was clear. If you're going to do it now. She covered the car's left taillight with her dish towel, drew back the hammer, and whacked. Bullseye. The largest plastic fragments dropped into the towel, and she swept everything else into the dustpan. Ted already had his excuse, a business meeting tonight at 8:30, and that meant he'd leave soon. Should she change clothes? Her dress was almost new, but this morning she punched a notch in the belt and cinched it tighter. 10 pounds gone. She was teetering on spilt, but Ted never noticed. Why bother? Besides, the blue-gray in the dress matched her new purse. She heard Ted trundling his squeaky wheelbarrow to the shed. He'd be 4, maybe 5 more minutes. Might as well try what her detective novels called a dry run. She darted to the closet, grabbed her paraphernalia, and opened the front door. Best time yet. Her breath escaped in short huffs. Ted came through the back door. Would he notice? Hoot-de-doodle. He wouldn't notice if her nose spewed nickels. When he stepped out of the bedroom, he was wearing his new shirt. Just as she predicted, a beige mixture of silk and linen. Were the pants new? One shade lighter than his shirt. The crease made his legs look longer. He leaned over to kiss her. Don't wait up. His cheek brushed hers, and musky cologne made her grip the armchair. Drive careful, she said. Feels like rain. The second he pulled out of the driveway, she swung open the closet door and grabbed her purse, sweater, and umbrella. The brown Ford she'd rented was parked 2 houses down. She picked it instead of the prettier gold Chevrolet for its anonymity. By the time she hit the ignition, Ted's car had vanished, but she gunned the engine and sped to the corner. Three blocks to her left, she spotted his missing taillight. The weatherman had been right. Raindrops grew fatter, fell closer together, and pummeled the roof. A truck passed, and water thrown from its wheels ghosted across her windshield. Where was Ted? He must have turned off.
No.
There he was, biffing along in the other lane. Rain, the kind she expected only at the ocean, lashed the car. Dawn flicked the wipers to high. Shatik, shatik, pressed the gas pedal, lifted her hands from the steering wheel, and waited to crash. The car swerved and she braked. Nope, she wanted Ted to crash. He drove past a gas station before turning into the parking lot of a flimsy motel that advertised hourly rates. No champagne room service here. She checked the mileage, halfway between home and office. He could have the tires on his car checked while he got lubed. She switched off the ignition but left the wipers on. Ted ducked across the parking lot and knocked on a door. With her sweater sleeve balled over her knuckles, she rubbed a peephole in the window's condensation, then leaned forward, but couldn't see who greeted him. 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It was time. When she opened the car door, rain pelted the side of her face. She aimed the umbrella out the door and slid back the spokes. The metal base pinched her finger, leaving a point of blood. Ted, the big baby, would have swooned. She flung the umbrella over the car seat. With her purse snugged under her arm, she marched at a middling pace across the parking lot and knocked a friendly tap at number 16. Water surged through a broken gutter. She knocked again, then pressed her ear to the door. "Who is it?" Ted's voice, juicy as a plum. She tapped a third time, louder. The door cracked open. "In. I want in. Don, what are you in? This isn't the time." She loosened the Velcro side pocket of her purse and with what she hoped was a dramatic flourish, whisked out the gun. "It's time, Ted. Believe you me, it's time." She smiled to show how little trouble she'd be and stepped inside. Her face was dappled with rain. A stubborn drop clung to the tip of her nose, and with the back of her left hand, she brushed it away. Marcy Heath leaned against the headboard, her smile big and juicy, just like Ted's voice. What was that woman doing here? A beanpole and not a bit pretty. Dawn expected better. Once more, Ted had let her down. When Heath yawned, her skirt hiked up her thighs. This immodesty seemed significant, the difference between wives and mistresses. If that was me, I'd tug my skirt over my knees. Now what? She thought everything through. Buying the gun, following Ted, facing off with his lover, played it all in her mind, but had never gone beyond this point. Shoot. Don't shoot. It seemed a point of etiquette, bad form not to. Dawn shut her eyes and squeezed the trigger. Pow! The knob on the headboard exploded. Even she was impressed. "Jesus, Dawn, have you lost your marbles?" "No, but you might." She lowered the muzzle and aimed at Ted's crotch. Marcy laughed and in a sly gesture pulled her skirt to an appropriate length. She decided to spare Marcy Heath. Her sweater sleeve fell over her arm and taking aim, she shoved it above her elbow.
Then a sign appeared that she interpreted as a message from God. A pea stain spread across Ted's pants and settled into the shape of Argentina. Shooting him now would be redundant.
Okay, this is a scene with our protagonist, Georgia Lamb. And she confronts Jonathan Kovac at his home in Savi Island. She's discovered that he's been stalking Judith Quist and fears for Judith's safety. It might also help to know that earlier in the book, Georgia's apartment was vandalized. No car in his driveway. Good. She was in a kicking down doors kind of mood, but when she turned the knob, it opened. Georgia leaned in. Honey, I'm home. No answer. The air inside was stale. No, something more. A sweet undercurrent of decay, like rotting fruit. While waiting for Jonathan's return, she'd conduct her own little tour. The kitchen's normalcy surprised her. Sunny yellow cupboards and a ceramic cookie jar shaped like a caboose. Down the hall, she found a locked room. If you live alone, why lock up? Her door-kicking fantasies returned. But since the front door hadn't been locked, maybe. She circled the house, found the corresponding window, and swish, it opened slick as silk. She boosted herself over the sill and tumbled inside. A white sheet stretched over the bed without the comforting lump of a pillow. Georgia rolled away from the window and was stunned by the photos on the far wall. Judith in work clothes, Judith riding a tractor with her father, Judith in family portraits, in pages ripped from high school yearbooks, Judith floor to ceiling in living color and black and white. Was there anything he wouldn't do to secure his place with Judith? Across the room stood a giant dresser, and on top, a fish tank burbled, but no fish swam through the bubbles. Georgia opened the top drawer and found more Judith memorabilia. A lipstick smudged paper napkin, black hair tied with red ribbon, canvas gardening gloves, and a shopping list in what must be Judith's handwriting. Buried under white t-shirts in the second drawer, she found an antique watch case and popped it open. Inside were guitar finger picks, brass Dunlops for three fingers and a thumb, the other set of clear plastic. Exactly like the one she used. Did Jonathan play? No guitars here. Judith? Nobody had mentioned that. She slid the Dunlops onto her thumb and fingers, a glass slipper of perfect fit. She scooped them up and dumped them in her pocket. These were going back home. She started reshuffling everything to their original order, then stopped. Screw it. Was he collecting souvenirs of her for later fantasies? Okay, but why utterly destroy her guitar and leave it on the bed like a dead lover? She had no doubt. Jonathan had ripped her place apart. She tried shutting the drawer, but a pair of white cotton panties pinched in the corner. Stark white, they looked new, but the inking on the tag, 100% cotton, see reverse side for care, had faded. She tugged on the elastic waistband and worked them loose, turned inside out. This had to be the treasure he'd snared from Judith's dumpster. Unwashed blood stained the gusset. In the bottom drawer, tucked behind thermal underwear, was a black metal case. Georgia snapped back the clasps and flipped the lid. A Luger pistol. Was this his father's gun? The gun that had killed his dog? A rustling came from outside. Seconds passed, but all she heard was the liquid babbling of the fish tank. She lifted the Luger, ejected the magazine, and pulled back the toggle to open the breech. Empty. A second search failed to produce a box of cartridges. The bedroom door unlocked from the inside with a turn latch, and she lugged the box into the living room and placed it on the table next to the Lazy Boy recliner. After rummaging in the wastebasket beside Jonathan's work table, she dumped crumpled wads of scrap paper under the curtains of the front window and heaped them into a fine mound worthy of a merit badge. No one would guess that she'd never been a Girl Scout. She flattened one ball of paper. While twisting it lengthwise, her breathing became rapid and shallow. If her feet hadn't been set wide apart, she would have wobbled, giddy. Could revenge be this close, this delicious? Her palm against the wall, she steadied herself. She pried Sean's lighter out of her pocket. The flint sparked and flames sputtered, orange and alive and vehement, writhing in the sunlight. By the time she reached her car, this place would be engulfed, a collapsing ruin. Through the door into the kitchen, she did a slow sideways dance, shielding the burning future in her hand. She could finish this. It was her right, tit for tat. The paper became a torch, smoking, charred, consuming. She dropped the paper into the sink, drowned it under the tap, and threw open the back door. Fresh air from the river scoured out the stink while she walked down the back steps to the top of the dike. The long wake behind a huge black tanker lapped the shore in a slow, persistent pulse. Rigid, she gazed across the water. A bundle of hate, self-loathing, and irrational stupidity, she waited for her heartbeat to echo the beat of the waves. All her struggles would be wasted in this descent. If she lost control, what would happen to Judith? A car backfired and sputtered, huffing up the long driveway to the house. "Welcome home, Johnny boy." She slunk up the back steps to the porch, through the kitchen, and into the living room, where she angled the recliner toward the door. After flopping into it, she positioned the Luger on the table next to her. "Hey, sweetie, it's about damn time. Remember your promise? If you're going to be late, call. Smell that?" A confused nod. The door closed behind Jonathan. "The meatloaf's ruined, my grandmother's recipe with onions diced the way you love them, burnt to hell, all burnt to hell." He stepped back and reached for the doorknob. It felt right that something in her made him retreat. "Take a little side trip, stalking Judith, did you? Or are you saving that for later? Safer to wait until dark." She twisted in the chair and peeked through the front curtains. "Where's the driver's ed car? Or do you save that just to follow me?" "What driver's ed car?" Jonathan, every word out of your mouth is a rotten old whopper. I hear penicillin clears that right up. Save your lies for real crimes, like stuffing bees down Thayer's chimney.